welcome to another episode of The Platform, and super cool to have director Alex Proyas on the show. He's one of Australia's best talents, so many amazing films, and he's recently put together an awesome YouTube channel. So many great videos on there about the industry, all the tips you can learn, and him sharing his knowledge, so you should definitely check it out. I sent him a message on Facebook to ask if he'd come on the show. He said yes, so we jumped on Skype and we filmed this. Alex, it's awesome to have you on the show. Thank you for your time.
Yeah, no worries. Pleasure.
Mate, I do a show all about stories, and I'd love to know how you got into this racket of being so creative and making films.
I've always made films. I started making films when I was 10, actually probably even before that. I managed to convince my parents to buy me a Super 8 camera when I was about 10. I think it was my 11th birthday, actually, that they bought it for me. And being an only child, I was able to convince them. I just annoyed them for long enough until they got me one. And then I had to buy the projector myself. I saved up my pennies to buy the projector eventually. So I've always wanted to make films. That's all I've ever wanted to do. And I'm not much good at anything else. So.
Wow. And you were born in Egypt.
I was born in Egypt. My parents are Greek Egyptian, and we moved to Australia when I was 3. So I'm pretty much an Aussie, I guess.
Do you have any memories at all at that stage, or did you go back as a kid to Egypt? That's a place I've always wanted to go. It's fascinating.
I've never been back, but I do have memories. Yeah, I've got it's really interesting how your memory works, and because there was such a shift in culture and location when I was 3, I know exactly the memories that I have from Egypt. You know, there's not many of them, but there's fleeting moments here and there. Images, people, even like I have this very strong memory of hands making something, I think cooking or making some dough or something, with the henna tattoo that they do in Middle Eastern countries. You know, those beautiful inner tattoos, and it was It was a friend. Friends. I eventually found out. I asked my dad whether he knows, and he couldn't remember. But he eventually remembered that there was this lady who had done that to her hands, and that was very specifically a memory from Egypt.
Wow, I was going to say it's so different to Australia. So just complete night and day.
Yeah. So it's not that strangely, it's not that different. The climate is actually very similar. And it's one of the reasons my parents came to live in Sydney in Australia, because the climate is not dissimilar. You know, where we're a very dry continent here in Australia, and Egypt is very similar in that respect.
You know? Okay, so what was school like for you? Were you the kind of guy that was always like doodling on your book and drawing these crazy stories, or if you're making films at school, it must have been pretty cool for your friends to like be in them, maybe.
Yeah, I'm an only child, and so changing your culture at that age, I was like, I think I was about 4 when we came to Australia. So I immediately started playing with the kids in the neighborhood, but I couldn't speak any English.
Wow.
And so I was the quiet kid. I didn't say anything for a long time. Kids are very, you know, very welcoming at that age. They don't really care that you're not saying anything. I somehow managed to play with them, and I didn't say a word for a year or more. And obviously could speak to my parents, but I didn't say anything to the local kids, because I was trying to understand the language and how to speak it, you know. And eventually I started being able to talk. And in school, I started making films in school, and even before I was awarded my gift of the Super 8 camera by my parents. And we were shooting. I remember we were shooting on video at the time. These big, massive. I remember lugging around this massive video, you know, camera, and with a separate videotape recorder that you'd have to put over your shoulder. Such primitive technology in those days, you know.
What do you reckon you'd be like today if someone handed you an iPhone 10 with everything you can do on it?
Yeah, well, I mean, that's what I say to people at the moment. I'm doing a lot of tutorials and masterclasses and stuff with people. And I said, there's no excuse now. If you want to be a filmmaker, you literally have no excuse. I mean, even when I got my Super 8 camera, just being able to buy enough, you know, we weren't a very affluent family, so being able to buy enough film stock, you know, it was expensive. This little 50-foot cartridge of film stock that you had to, it shot for 3 minutes at 18 frames a second, no sound, just silent, and you'd have to send it off to a laboratory in Melbourne.
Oh, my God.
And wait several weeks for it to return. And the whole, I can't remember exactly how much it cost, but it was quite expensive, you know. So at an early age, I learned the discipline of only shooting what you needed to, you know. Now, of course, we don't have those restrictions on what we shoot. You know, everyone's got one of these things, you know, most people do. Most people get one of these things when they're like, you know, the age that I got my Super 8 camera. And so you can shoot a movie, you can edit a movie on your laptop. There is literally no reason not to do that. If you want to be a filmmaker, you can do it. It's as simple as that, you know.
So after school for you, I mean, I Googled you obviously and read up, and you went to, was it AFTERS? And then, you know, you start directing music videos, but there must be some great memories looking back working with Crowded House and INXS.
Yeah, I mean, the music videos were fun for a while. They were, I equate them with when movies first were invented, no one really knew the rules of movie making. So filmmakers were very free to make it up as they went along, and music videos were much the same. When I got into it, it was like the early days of MTV, and record companies were just really understanding how important it was to promote their acts through these things called music videos. And so we were left to do whatever we wanted to do. And of course, I always wanted to make movies. So we turned every short music video into feature length, you know, story, narrative thing, you know, had great fun doing it. But over the course of several years, the record company more and more realized, or they thought they realized, what a music video should be. So we'd get notes like, get plenty of close-ups of the drummer smiling, you know, to show that he's got a great personality. You know, he's always in the background, never always ignored. So it started to become less free and less creative, and right, more of a, you know, the rules started to creep in, which is sad when that happens, you know. Falling down the mountain, amethyst dust, the
So going into feature films, and I mean, people around the world, I'm sure, I mean, everyone knows The Crow. How did that project come to be for you?
I through my success in commercials and music videos, because I used to do a lot of ads as well, and I had quite a bit of success in America. You know, I went and would live there for periods of time, and because, you know, the Aussie film industry was nowheresville. It wasn't happening, you know. Sadly, it's probably, you know, still the case to this day. It's very hard for, you know, a filmmaker to get something going here, a feature length film going here, you know. So I decided on, you know, the US route, and I had such success in the music video world that there were a lot of people, you know, the timing was right. There were a lot of agents, Hollywood agents out there looking for young filmmakers from music videos and commercials. And I was one of those, you know, guys around at that time. And so I had a lot of agents chasing me to do stuff, and eventually got an agent in LA. And then, of course, I got all the terrible scripts that were flying around, like Nightmare on Elm Street and stuff like that I didn't really want to do, you know, sequels and stuff. And then eventually The Crow came along, and as the comic book of The Crow, you know, which I quite liked, you know.
Wow. So, I mean, obviously, it's probably still tough for you to talk about, but that film's so well known because of obviously Brandon Lee, and apart from being a great film, but I guess not many people would have that experience of having someone, their leading man, pass away during a shoot. So that must have been a crazy experience for you.
Yeah, of course. Yeah. I mean, Brandon was a very good friend. So it's still to this day very heartrending and horrible situation, you know. But we finished the film for Brandon. You know, I didn't want to really finish the film. And his fiance at the time and his family, his mother in particular, kind of motivated me to finish it because we all watched the film and they saw what great work he did. So they felt that it was going to be his legacy, which in fact it's turned out to be. So I'm very pleased that we finished the film. I think Brandon would have been.
People once believed that when someone dies, a crow carries their soul to the land of the dead. But sometimes, just sometimes, the crow could bring that soul back to put the wrong things right.
Is that gasoline I smell?
Victims, aren't we all?
It's an epic film, and
I
had Bai Ling on the show, and she was telling me that at the time that I don't know whether you had a lot to do with casting her or whatever, but she couldn't really speak English at the time.
No, I did cast. Yeah, I cast Bai Ling, and I was aware of her limitations, let's say, with the English language. She auditioned. She learnt the audition phonetically. Someone taught it to her. But she had such an interesting quality, I thought it was worth giving it a shot, you know. And,
yeah, she's amazing in it.
Yeah, she's a very unique person for sure. But then,
you know. Big time. So Dark City, yeah. I mean, that's a great project, and you wrote, produced and direct that, so that must have been a big chunk of your life.
Yeah, well, Dark City was, you know, there's projects that you do that come together very easily. Or relatively easily. Nothing's easy in the film industry, of course, but projects can come together quite quickly at times. And then there are other projects like Dark City, which I was working on for years, rewriting, and it was the thing I really wanted to do. And The Crow's success at the box office gave me the all the studios after The Crow were wanting to make my next movie, and it was always, you know, what do you want to make? And I'd say, I'd hand them Dark City as a script, and they'd say, well, what else do you want to make? You know? So I just stuck with it. And eventually someone, studio agreed to finance it. And because it was pretty out there. I mean, there have been so many movies since Dark City that have explored similar territory, but at the time it was a absolutely unique concept, and a lot of people just didn't know what to make of it at all, because, you know, film executives don't have a great deal of imagination. You've always got to compare your work to something else, you know,
right,
to get it made. So I couldn't really compare Dark City to anything.
I find when I see your stuff, I mean, I'm one of those people too that has a dream of one day making a film. I'm sure so many people that watch movies think, man, I want to make a film one day. But when I see your stuff, it's almost intimidating because there's so much going on in the world you create, so like detailed. How do you do that?
I'm very obsessive, I guess. And thanks for saying so. I think detail is really important. I think when you're making worlds, which is what I like to do, I like to create worlds and live in those worlds. And I think to create worlds that are convincing so that the audience believe in the story and the characters that you're showing them, you need to make the world very detailed, very textural, you know. And I mean, you know, I've been inspired by other filmmakers who have done that in the past. And that's what I've liked about the work is their attention to detail. I think that's really important. And you know, you just work through it a day at a time and, you obsess over the most minute thing. And somehow these films get made, you know. It's a relief when you're working on a film that's set in the real world. Not that I've made a lot of those, but I've made a couple that are kind of in the real world or my version of the real world. And it's great that you don't have to decide on everything, you know. When you're dealing in a fantasy world or a science fiction world, you know, you got to decide what a doorknob looks like, you know. someone presents you with two doorknobs or three doorknobs and says,
you have a nervous breakdown.
Like, you know, and it's like, just fine, whatever. I'm fine with any of those doorknobs, you know. And then if you start making something with the real world, that doesn't happen so much, which is a bit refreshing, I have to say.
Well, yeah, like I said, it's intimidating, but I also realize that it'd be an incredible amount of stress because then you do a film like I, Robot, and you've got Will Smith, who I guess at that time was just becoming like this bankable, huge brand himself, and the world you created for that. What's it like being the director of a film like I, Robot?
Well, Will was the best part of it, I have to say. I mean, he was at the time, he was the biggest movie star in the world and making the most money per movie. But he's a really nice guy, really refreshingly down to earth, sensible guy, you know. When we did our junket of the, you know, we go around the world and promote the movie. So we were hanging out for a long time. This is after the film, obviously. You know, I brought along my wife and Will brought along his wife and his mum. His mum came along, you know.
Wow.
And actually getting to know his mum showed me why Will is the down-to-earth guy that he is, you know. She's like really no-nonsense, and if he'd ever swear, like act by accident, she'd tell him off and say, don't use that language around me.
Yeah.
I think that's part of the reason he's such a down-to-earth guy. So that was actually really easy, you know. And Will is the sort of guy that he responds to anyone, doesn't matter who you are, whether you're the president of the United States or, you know, some fan on the street, he talks to everyone on the same level. He treats everyone the same, you know.
Yeah.
I think that's why people like him, you know. But the studio was a nightmare, and partly because it was a Will Smith vehicle, as they call it, it was a big budget, by far the biggest budget I'd ever had, still is actually. There was a lot of nervousness about the project and micromanagement and just the worst experience, you know, from that. I've been pretty lucky. I had a lot of freedom up until that point, you know. And suddenly I was in like the big Hollywood studio league, you know, and not something I enjoyed and not something I particularly want to repeat, actually.
We designed them to be trusted with our homes, with our way of life, with our world. But did we design them to be trusted?
The rollout of USR's new generation of robot, the NS5, was marred by the death of designer Alfred Lanning.
Identify. Murder's a new trick for a robot. Respond.
I did not murder him!
We're gonna miss the good old days.
What good old days?
When people were killed by other people.
My robots don't kill people.
That thing threw somebody out of a window. Is that registering with you?
A robot cannot harm a human being.
And you trust him if you want to.
We look to robots for protection. Imagine the loss of all that we've gained because of an irrational paranoia.
Does thinking you're the last sane man on the face of the earth make you crazy? Because if it does, maybe I am.
Maybe you can be looking in the shadows all the time.
On the inside, help me find out what is wrong with these robots.
Dr. Lanning suggested robots might naturally evolve.
I was hoping to see you again, Detective. Think of me as your friend.
Why didn't you just hand the world over on a silver platter?
Maybe we did.
We're on the eve of the largest robotic distribution in history. There'll be one robot to every five humans.
How many robots have ever committed a crime? How many robots in the world?
None.
There is no conspiracy. What this is one mistake.
Oh, hell no. Somehow, I told you so, just doesn't quite say it.
Get off my car!
How does that work as far as if they say, okay, we're going to give you $100 million to make a movie, what kind of pressure is on you knowing that most people think, oh, it made $105 million at the box office, it's a success, but it's actually, you've pretty much got to make three times that, don't you?
Well, that's not true. That's a myth that's propagated by Hollywood studios, quite frankly. It's actually nowhere near that. Which I was also, you know, filmmakers are generally aware of it. It's a myth that's propagated because it services the agenda of the film studios. They want you to make a lot of profit, you know. iRobot, just to give you an idea, and we all, you know, filmmakers get a percentage, we get a cut of the box office, right? So you probably think I'm a billionaire by now, having made several movies that have made a lot of money, but I'm not, and I've received not a single cent from the profit of iRobot. iRobot at the time made $500 million in box office, right? It's still, in Hollywood's creative accounting, it still has not made a cent of profit, you know? And all I can say is Hollywood seems to make endless movies that don't make any profit with that math that's going on there. Somehow they continue to make them, you know? So it's all just bullshit.
So the guy with the best office at the studio is probably the accountant.
Well, there's an army of them.
Technology has given filmmakers unprecedented freedom. So make your damn movie. What's stopping you? The web is full of bad advice, happy, smiling people urging you to be kind to yourself, not to try too hard to make your film career happen overnight. A sensitive new age approach for sensitive new age people. Alas, no successful filmmaker ever made it by being anything less than tough as nails. When you make films, you are in the trenches, bombarded by enemy fire. That's every filmmaker, newbie, indie, or established. You don't need to be an asshole to anyone. But you have to push yourself to breaking point physically, spiritually, and creatively. There is no greater test than making a good film. If you're not a born fighter, if you're easily disappointed, if you can't deal with rejection, if you lose your tenacity after one person tells you, don't bother, or even 100 tell you that, you picked the wrong career. Well, the newsflash is in professional filmmaking, it never gets any better. Doesn't matter how many films you've made, tenacity is what it's all about. You'll be climbing that mountain your entire career. You'll never reach the peak. You need to revel in that challenge.
I see the videos you've been putting on YouTube, these tutorials, and it must be pretty cool to be giving out advice to people all around the world. What's it like for you to do that?
Well, I mean, what we were saying earlier is a big important part of it is if you want to make films, there's no reason not to, you know. I'm actually going to Goulburn in the next few couple of weeks to teach some rural-based, you know, filmmakers how to make films. And I'm literally showing them the essentials, you know, which is what I use to make these little YouTube things, you know, which is a very simple camera setup and an editing setup that you know, I can put on my laptop. And it's all really, you know, you can produce very high quality stuff for not much technology, you know. And as we say, even the phones, the quality coming out of the phones is these days is pretty damn good. I mean, you know, some people are even making features on their phones, you know. So that's my main thing, is to say, you know, don't be intimidated by the technology, because you can do it. It doesn't matter how much money or how little money or how few resources. If you want to make films, you can make them, and that's the way to do it. And I also think that these days, you know, to not think of going down the same, you know, conservative commercial channels, you know, YouTube, you know, allowing people like yourself to do what you do and me to start doing stuff on YouTube, it's a wonderful thing, you know, it really is. It's democratizing the whole filmmaking process. You know, there's a downside, you know, I've got to become like a, you know, multimedia personality now to make films, you know, which is kind of weird for me, because I've spent so long just not wanting to be, but I want to be in front of the camera, I want to be behind the camera, you know. But it's a means to an end, you know. And so, you know, for me, there's a great deal of hope and optimism about filmmaking, getting away from the big commercial franchises, which I think are the death of Hollywood movie making. Do your own thing, be original, tell a story that only you can tell. Don't mimic, copy other stuff, you know, and just go out and do it, you know.
I'd written a new script, but the studio financing the movie wanted it to be more superhero-y. I kept telling them it wasn't about superheroes, but they wouldn't listen. Everything's about superheroes these days, they'd say. They wanted more lycra and capes and flexing biceps and six-packs in my script, where there was none of that stuff. It was just a damn drama. And one executive had a great idea for the title:
Spandex Apocalypse.
I woke up screaming. Making movies is being endlessly told you're wrong and others know better. The voices of reason teach you from the beginning there are rules or laws you must obey if you want to be a successful filmmaker. Rules about story, about character development, about shot structure. Your common sense tells you otherwise, as it seems all the movies you like frequently break those rules and follow their own.
Yeah, well, that's great advice. I was going to ask you, if you could go back in time and give yourself advice, you know, looking back on the career you've had, what do you think you'd tell yourself about maybe even, I don't know, doing it differently, or what do you think you'd say?
Oh, I don't know. You're responding to the immediate film industry that's in front of your face, you know, and things have changed so much. The film industry now has no relationship at all to the one I started in, even with, you know, The Crow in 1993, right? 25, 26 years ago, it's a completely different paradigm. There's no similarity, nothing at all, from the technology to the way films are shown, to the way films are distributed, to the type of films that are made. Completely different, you know. So all you can do as whether you're an experienced, you know, veteran like me or someone starting off, is respond immediately to the climate around you, you know. So I'm trying to keep changing, you know, and keep moving forward, and that's why I've embraced things like YouTube, because you have to, otherwise you'll die in the mud like a dinosaur, you know. And that's all any of us can do, you know, and I think, but I've always been that way. I mean, for me, I've always embraced change. I like new technology. I like the fact that it frees us up and opens up new opportunities, new doorways, you know. So that's, yeah, same as it ever was, really.
Well, you've had a great career. Your films are incredible. I love asking people, you know, what they'd do if they could live the ultimate dream. So what would be the ultimate dream for you, if you can live it?
The ultimate dream, well, the ultimate dream is to have freedom in my art, you know. That's really all I've really wanted, is just to be able to make my films, tell my stories, and not have, you know, schmucks coming down on me telling me how to do it and why I'm doing it wrong, you know. So that, to me, is the ultimate goal. Whether or not any of us can ever achieve that, I don't know. But, you know, it's something to head for, at least.
Yeah. Well, Alex, it's so great to have you for a quick chat on Skype. Really appreciate you coming on the show. I'm a big fan, and all the best with all the stuff you're doing. And, yeah, man, thanks for your time.
No worries. Cheers. Thank you.
So there you have it. Super fun to have him on the show. Really cool. And thanks for watching. Hope you enjoyed it. And we'll see you next time on the platform.